Another top story for the evening that we have been tracking is the message that the Apex Court is sending out, that bail will continue to be the norm and jail the exception. And it does so by way of an order which has held Section 45(1) of the PMLA as unconstitutional. Now, technical as it may seem, it's relevant because this section was one that had been cited by the government as a key part of its fight against black money. What it effectively does, Section 45(1), is that it places two preconditions on the grant of bail, before the grant of bail, while a person is being tried, while a party is being tried under PMLA. Now, what's critical are those two preconditions. The first precondition is that the prosecutor will be given a chance to oppose. That's the second. The second precondition essentially is that the court more or less will have to be prima facie convinced that the person in question, that the party in question, is not guilty before the grant of bail. Now, both these preconditions read together effectively meant that it was virtually impossible to secure bail, and that appears to be the reasoning before the Apex Court. The Apex Court has held it to be arbitrary, to be violative of Article 14, or to be violative of Article 21, and on that count, the Apex Court has struck Section 45(1) down. To explore what the implications could be, what the facets of this judgment are, to take that conversation forward, we have with us this evening Mr. KTS Tulsi, Senior Advocate. Mr. Tulsi, appreciate you taking our time for us. The first question that I'll pose to you are some of the arguments that the Attorney General had made in this case. The Attorney General, in defense of Section 45(1), had said that this legislation is an attempt by the Parliament to get back money which has been siphoned off from the economy. He went on to add that it was meant to unearth black money so that the laundered money is brought back. That appears to be the defense of the government, that this is a key aspect, that there are teeth that we need in our legislation to tackle black money. Does this now effectively dent the government's offensive that we have seen in the recent past against black money, with Section 45(1) now being struck down?
Yes, I think it's a well-deserved rebuke from the court. And the fact is that the Constitution gives every citizen the right of silence. And under Section 45, you were expected to first establish that you are not guilty. So the burden stands shifted, and if you don't disclose the source, then a presumption is being drawn that you are guilty. Now, that is clearly unconstitutional, because the Constitution says that no one shall be compelled to be a witness against himself. So I think that this is a revolutionary judgment. These kind of provisions were found only under the Tada Act, that is Terrorist Activities Prevention Act. And in Tata, it was upheld because that was the question of the security and safety of the citizens. And when terrorism was raging very high in Punjab, in Kashmir, and Northeast, it's at that time that this was brought in, and it was held to be valid. But now, for economic offenses, in normal circumstances, if you are going to invoke similar provision as is contained in Section 45, it would be arbitrary, and it would also violate the citizen's right of silence. That's the highest value of the Constitution. You can't, for not being able to, after all, if there is an economic offense, you are supposed to investigate. And if where people have even declared in the income tax returns, why should they not be at least granted bail? And to say that the court has to record a finding of not guilty means that you have to prove yourself to be not guilty, whereas the criminal jurisprudence that is valid under Article 21 of the Constitution, it presumes everyone to be innocent. And the burden is on the prosecuting agency to establish that you have committed an offense. Now, to say that the accused must show that he has not committed an offense is most abhorrent to the rule of law.
Fair enough. Innocent until proven guilty, that has been the jurisprudence that we have seen develop in India. But coming back to what the government had been arguing, the government's essential contention was that as a part of our battle against black money, as a part of this money laundering act, it's critical that we have teeth. Teeth in the form of sections such as Section 41, which make it difficult for under trials to come out on bail. That was the government's contention, that it's a key aspect of the fight against black money. Do you think that, in your assessment, when you look at this judgment, will it now dent the government's offensive on the black money front?
No, this in fact amounts to terror itself, spreading terror amongst taxpayers. And they can arbitrarily choose whom to attack, and many a times these raids have been made on political considerations. So I'm sure that the court has taken into account the fact that merely because you can raid, you have been given draconian powers under the Act, and yet you say that it is the accused who must show that he is not guilty. You have the power of search, seizure. You have the power to get the accounts and to get the CDRs. If the prosecution can't establish it, how is a citizen going to establish his innocence? That will be turning the criminal jurisprudence on its head.
Fair enough, Mr. Tulsi. Appreciate the time that you have taken out to throw more light on that judgment, a key development there. The government, at least on the face of it, prima facie, appears to have suffered a dent in terms of its fight against black money. KTS Tulsi there calling it a draconian provision, which deserved to be struck down by the apex court. Thank you.